Hi guys, this is the next screencast on anatomy and physiology, and this one's going to be discussing sort of diseases and problems with the musculoskeletal system. As always, just make good notes and bring them along to the lesson. Okay, one of the first problems we find with the skeletal system and indeed the muscular system is osteoporosis. And you might have heard of osteoporosis before. It's very common in the elderly, but it can affect lots of different people. Osteoporosis is caused by low bone density and the deterioration of bone tissue. And what that does is it means basically your bones are breaking up very slowly, and it severely weakens the overall bone, so little ends of it can start to fracture, and those little fractures can become larger fractures and then becoming total breaks. The risk factors associated with osteoporosis: if you're not very active during childhood, adolescence or adulthood, it could mean you are at more risk to suffer from osteoporosis in later life. If you have a serious injury at any time within your life, really, that leads to what we call a sedentary lifestyle, which means you're not doing a lot, you're sitting on the sofa a lot watching TV, eating the wrong foods, not doing enough exercise, really, a sedentary lifestyle, it could mean that the chance of you actually getting osteoporosis are quite high, because you're not doing any physical activity at all, and therefore your bones aren't getting stronger, they're actually getting weaker. Now, how to minimise this risk? If you can manage to gain a high peak bone density, will reduce the risk of osteoporosis. So if you can make your bones stronger, it will reduce gaining osteoporosis in later life. And how do we do this? Well, if we use loading exercise or high impact activities during adolescence, so the ages of sort of 13, 14, 15, teenage lifestyle, even up to the age of 19 and 21, where we call early adulthood, we can prevent osteoporosis happening. Now, what do we mean by loading exercises? Well, we mean using heavy weights. So we're loading our arms, we're putting more stress on the bone and making them stronger, they repair quicker. Generally, weight training exercises are a good example of this, but you could also have high impact activities such as rugby, American football, wrestling, those sort of high impact, lots of stress, lots of strength required, and pressure on those bones to help them build and become stronger. Growth plate injuries are also very common. Now, a growth plate is a delicate area between the shaft and the ends of a long bone, and I'll show you a diagram of that in a minute. Growth plates are often in the bones of children and adolescents, so early to mid-teens, young children, and they're the weakest point of a growing skeleton, so they're always the weakest point of a bone. Because your bones are growing, if we hit these areas, they're very prone to fractures. So as you can see in the diagram, here is a growth plate on the left. So it's this end of the bone that's still growing. It's stretching your bone out and adding new areas of bone to it each and every day while you're in childhood or young adolescence. So your bones grow. Now, these areas are very prone to small and tiny fractures that eventually end up accumulating to a break. And what can also happen is something such as twisting your ankle for an adult would end up being a complete fracture for a young child, because the growth plates have not reached full adulthood in terms of how their bones are developed. They're not strong enough, so they can end up breaking. Okay, risk factors here. The impact injuries generally occur in that weak area, the ends of the bone, the growth plate area. So that's both ends of the bone, not just one end. Generally speaking, a complete fracture, so a growth plate fracture shown in the picture on the right, often caused by a sudden force travelling through the bone in that growth plate area. So if you are tackled, let's say on the shin, the lower part of the shin between the shin and the ankle, the growth plate is still growing in a child, that could be a complete fracture for a child. The other way you can get a growth plate injury is by repetitive injuries, and that's by just keep on doing the same action again and again and again as you're a child or through young adolescence, and that causes tiny fractures on the end of that bone and causes an eventual break or swelling of that area where the fractures have become larger in the growth plate area. Good examples of this are shin splints. So you get immense pain after you've been running around because your bones are still growing. Tennis elbow is a very good example. So the ends of that bone become slightly fractured and you get tennis elbow. And the other famous one is Oscar Schlatter's in the knees. Many of you might have had that. It's just where the only cure for those three injuries is complete rest to allow the bones to heal and to grow to full strength. Osteoarthritis sounds very similar to osteoporosis, but is different, and this is to do with the joints in your body at various points. Osteoarthritis is caused by the breakdown and loss of articular cartilage at a joint. So at the ends of our bone, we have what's called cartilage, which acts as a shock absorber between the two bones that meet. Now, when we break that shock absorber down, the cartilage, as we run it down, it ends up becoming so that the two bones grind on each other where your joints meet, rather than rubbing against the shock absorber, rubbing against the cartilage and being nice and easy to move. The bones end up grating on each other and causes swelling of the joint and immense pain. It's very painful. So if we see this joint here, the joint on the left is a normal joint. Joint on the right, as you can see, the cartilage on the end of the bone has started to thin out, and then the bones start rubbing against each other as you use that joint. So that could be the knee, could be under your patella, and it becomes really, really painful. Risk factors here. Generally speaking, it mostly affects the weight-bearing joints. So if you think most of your body weight is on your upper body, upper to mid-body, so we're talking about knees and ankles are the joints that are often affected here because they're always used. Lots of stress on them. If we keep using these joints, so repetitive use, it starts to wear down that cartilage, which is why overuse injuries are quite important concepts in sport. Not to do too much or to do a lower impact activity if you're doing a lot of exercise. So eventually over time that degenerates the cartilaginous cushion, so the buffer degenerates, and it causes frictional grating between the bones as we spoke about earlier. So if you become obese, you're putting tremendous stress when you're doing exercise on your knee joints and ankle joints, and that is removing the cartilage from your knees and joints. However, if you change the activity to some activity where there is less stress on the joints, you can do two things. You can reduce your overall body weight, so your aerobic exercise will reduce the body weight, so less fat means less stress on my knees, less stress on my ankles, and also you're keeping those joints mobile, so you're keeping them healthy at the same time. Last one I'm going to talk about is joint stability. And what we mean by joint stability is within every joint it's problematic if you don't partake in physical activity, because the cartilage, as we've already spoken about with osteoarthritis, but also the ligaments and synovial fluid become affected if you don't do regular exercise. Also within joints, if you have a joint that's very mobile, such as a ball and socket joint, or a pivot joint, for example, is quite mobile, saddle joint fairly mobile, those more mobile joints can become dislocated or sprained very easily. Most rugby players will associate dislocated shoulders. Generally in football, common problems occur within the knee because they're a little bit more mobile to do with the sport. So if we see a joint here, in the middle of the joint, it's what we call synovial fluid. There's a white area in the middle there. And as we use our joint in physical activity, the bones and the body start to produce more synovial fluid. It's a bit like lubricant between the joint and makes your joints move easier. So the more physical activity, the more synovial fluid, the more easier that joint can work. Also, if you provide more activity, the ligaments, which join bone to bone, also become more supple and you end up with a more flexible joint because they're being used regularly. The cartilage is also highly effective within physical activity, and you obviously know what happens when we do load bearing with cartilage. It removes that cartilage from the joint. Risk factors then. Ligaments can shorten. If we don't do any activity at all or have a sedentary lifestyle, the ligaments end up shortening between your joints, which means excruciating pain between those joints as we move, and it also reduces flexibility. The muscle tone around that joint reduces, so your muscles become less stronger, putting more pressure on that joint. The synovial fluid, which we talked about a minute ago, in the middle of that joint, starts to become reduced. Your body doesn't start to produce it because it's not being used. Imagine Darwin's effect on animals over a period of time. If an animal wouldn't use its ears or its senses, they would actually reduce them. So the body naturally does that with joints. We naturally reduce the synovial fluid because the joints aren't being used so much because we're not so physically active. And ultimately that means your entire joint loses flexibility. You become less flexible within those joints. There is a risk of high impact or load bearing activities on joints, such as squatting or weightlifting, puts extreme pressure on those joints, as we talked about osteoporosis. However, it will build peak bone density, so it minimises the risk of osteoporosis, but actually accentuates the risk of osteoarthritis, so you need to be careful there. Other sports such as rugby, American football, wrestling, high impact sports actually cause massive problems for joints. As you can see there, if someone's tackled on his wrist joint there, probably likely to be a break, a sprain or a fracture. There is also high chance of breaking legs, dislocating shoulders, etc. because of the joints involved. Okay, as per usual, make extensive notes on this, bring them to class, and we'll discuss a little bit more in the lesson. There is one more to discuss about, which is muscle tone and posture, but otherwise than that, that's it, folks.